a massage nurse. Today I'm going to be doing the pathologies for the nervous system, part one. I'm going to be talking about Alzheimer's disease, attention deficit, hyperactivity disorder, autism, Bell palsy, carpal tunnel syndrome, double crush syndrome, and herniated and bulging discs. So I'm going to start with the Alzheimer's disease, which is a neurodegenerative illness. It produces mental disorientation and thinking and affects their memory, and they have a difficult time communicating. So make sure you do a really good intake and find out what stage your client is in. This is something that you might see in nursing homes. It's a form of dementia. And so they forget that in the later stages, they forget who you are. They might ask you a lot of questions. So make sure that you do have a lot of patience with people with Alzheimer's. It does affect the frontal and occipital parts of the brain. And there's few adjustments needed as far as the massage is concerned, especially in the beginning stages. You might not need to make any adjustments, but the more they progress, the more that you need to adjust and be patient with them. They might ask you the same question over and over again, and they might ask you, why am I here, or, you know, what are you going to do, and who are you? And, you know, you just have to be compassionate and understanding, because it is, as the illness progresses, the disease progresses, it will be a little bit worse. And one of the suggestions that I have when it's in the later stages is that they really enjoy hand and arm massages. And the later stages, they might not be able to, you know, to let you touch their shoulders if they can't see you. It's better if they can see you, you know, and you can work their hands and, like I said, their arms. So there's not a lot of accommodations except for make sure your client's always, you know, comfortable. The next one is attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. And that's also a neurological disease. And the symptoms are inattentiveness, hyperness, impulsivity, or a combination of all three. So those are really people that have worse symptoms when you have a combination of being hyper and inattentive. And, you know, they're very impulsive. Like, yes, they want it, and they want it right now. You might want to accommodate by having a shorter session. Usually, they usually get diagnosed from a medical doctor, you know, by the time that they are 7 years old. And if you have a child that has ADHD, you really want to taper the massage, you know, to maybe 20 minutes, 30 minutes. Oh, and something I want to remind you guys is make sure that anytime you have anybody in your office younger than 17 years old, that you have the parent sign the consent form that you can work on them, and the parent must be in the room with you. They can't say, oh, well, I'm going to go get gas, or I'm going to go get coffee. No, they must be in the room with you and make sure they sign the consent form that you can work under, you know, their children under 17. So they might be very fidgety. They might forget their appointments. They might forget their phone. They forget their keys. They, you know, so people with ADHD, you know, really my heart goes out to them, because they don't mean to do all those things. They just, you know, their attention span, you know, really is less. And massage does really help them. It helps them to focus. Helps them to focus in school. It helps with anger control, with, you know, with their mood, with relaxation. And like I said, the adjustments might be, even for adults, maybe just a 30-minute massage instead of an hour. And for children, maybe a 20-minute massage. And I've had students that have ADHD, and it's difficult for them to learn and to sit still. You know, I've had several students that have ADHD, and they have to get up. And I allow that, you know, they need to get up and go get a drink of water or go to the bathroom, because it's hard for them to sit still for a long period of time. And, you know, you have to learn which way you do learn better, whether it's by, you know, listening or observing or, you know, repeating it yourself. So make sure that you know what type of learner you are, too, especially if you have ADHD. And I want to recommend a very good book to you that has made changes in my life and in other people's life. Is the name of the book is ADHD Advantage by Dale Archer. It is a great book for people that have ADHD. What you thought was a diagnosis can now be your, you know, your greatest strength. So make sure and check that book out, The ADHD Advantage. That'll help people with ADHD. It'll also help parents, because I know parents lose patience with their kids because of the attention deficit and the hyperactivity. Make sure that, you know, they're enrolled in some kind of sport or something to let that energy, another venue to let some of that energy out. Next will be autism. Autism spectrum disorder, and that's diagnosed usually in early childhood. By the age of two or three, the parents start noticing that they have a problem communicating and forming relationships outside of their home. You know, they have a difficult time forming relationships, and always ask if a parent brings in the child that has autism. Make sure that you ask what their triggers might be, where they're hypersensitive to, whether they're hypersensitive to the music or, you know, the smells or, let me see, what else? Or the textures, smells, sound, touch, you know, if they don't like, you know, like you might want to start with their hands, not right away with their back, so get them used to that touch. And I did have a teenage young man that was 13, and he couldn't lay still for very long, and he wasn't, so I had to accommodate for that. You know, it was like a 20, 30-minute massage at the most. He wore his headphones. I allowed for him to wear his headphones because that really helped him with his own music. He really relaxed, and he enjoyed the scent of the lavender, but he didn't enjoy any other scents, you know, that I ever had. Like if I had candles, I had to turn them off. Another thing that he did not like was the texture of the massage cream. He only could handle the lotion, so be sensitive to that. Find out what their triggers are. Find out from the parents. And don't forget, have the parents sign the form, the consent form, if they are under 17, and the parent must be in the room. Next is the Bell palsy, and this is a neurological condition to the facial nerve number 7, that's the facial nerve, where half of their face droops. They have no, you know, it becomes very flaccid, you know, they have no control over their eye. I actually had a client, and she was young, she was only like 30 years old, and she had Bell palsy, and she couldn't close her eye, and it was like really freaky that you're working on her, and you know, she's got one eye closed and the other one is open, and she would tell me that she would have to tape it shut at night because, or sometimes throughout the day, she would have to tape it shut because it would get really dry because they can't blink. So, you know, their face droops. It's kind of scary, I'm sure. Some people just wake up with it, and I'm sure it's very scary to think that you might be having a stroke, because those are some symptoms of a stroke when your face, you know, starts getting distorted. But Bell's palsy usually is unilateral, only on one side, and it's okay to massage it, you know, to do strokes going up, effleurage and petrissage, and you can do a full body because it really helps with a, you know, with a stress, anxiety of having Bell's palsy. They don't know what the cause is, but they suspect that stress may aggravate it and that it might be viral. So make sure that you use light pressure and keep your client comfortable. However, you can give a full body massage and just gentle and less pressure on the face. Strokes always going up. Next is carpal tunnel syndrome, and this is compression of the median nerve through the carpal tunnel. The carpal tunnel is formed, you know, by the 9 tendons that go through the flexor retinaculum, which is on the anterior part right here on the wrist. So you have one nerve, the median nerve, that goes through there. And the carpals go up to about right here on your hand, you know. You've got your ulnar and your radial bone, and then your carpal start here and up to about right here. There's 2 rows, and then the 9 nerves that go through there. There's very little space in that carpal tunnel because it is one nerve and 9 tendons. So when that nerve gets swollen or the tendons get swollen or anything like that, it really can cause a lot of pain. People lose their grip. It's very important for you to work the flexors and extensors. That really does help. I've had clients both with before surgeries and after surgeries, and one of the best things that really helps them is the massage of the forearm muscles, you know, the flexors and the extensors, and then, of course, you know, right through the carpal tunnel right here. It helps with grip after you've worked on them. It really helps them to have a better grip, to relax those muscles. Of course, we know that it's repetitive motion. People that are, you know, are gaming all the time, or certain hand positions, make sure that ergonomics are right if they work on the computer, that they're not doing this, you know. So help your clients figure out what can help them to relieve some of that pain, hopefully prior to having surgery. The next one will be double crush syndrome. And double crush syndrome is compression of a nerve through two locations along the same, you know, along the same, it happens in the peripheral nerves. So let's say you've got your brachial nerve through the brachial plexus and then the median nerve. And let's say it's being pressed here and here it's being compressed. So double crush means it's being crushed in two places along the same pathway, peripheral pathway. So let's say if it is the brachial plexus and then the median nerve, then you would treat it the same as carpal tunnel syndrome or thoracic outlet syndrome to relieve some of that pressure from the muscles tightening and putting pressure on that nerve. Okay, next or last will be the herniated and bulging discs. So a herniated, think of a herniated disc like a flat tire. All the air comes out of your tire, and that's the way, you know, herniated disc. And a bulging disc is a slip disc, but not all the air or, you know, gel is coming out of it. As a matter of fact, I have a little example here that I thought might help you. On the herniated disc, it's a ruptured, you know, it's the ruptured pulpus, you know, what is it called? A protrusion of the pulpus nucleus is broken. There's a hole in it. So there's a hole in it. And so this is your disc. Let's pretend that this is your disc. So there's a hole. This is, you know, the cushion, the bursa in between, and the pulpus has already gone out. There's a hole, and it's all dripping out. So this is a herniated disc, like a flat tire. All the air comes out of it. So this is when, you know, it really goes flat. So it might be just bone to bone. Now, a bulging disc is like the s'mores, where you get the fluffy marshmallow in between, and it kind of comes out, and you squeeze it, and it's not broken. However, it, you know, it's coming out, you know, especially if you have an anterior tilt. It happens more commonly in the lumbar area, you know, people that have, you know, it happens a lot in pregnancy, or people that have low, weak abdominal muscles or are overweight. And so your pelvis might be tilted, you know, anteriorly, and it starts putting pressure on the disc, and then it becomes, you know, like a bulge, like, you know, like I said, like a marshmallow when you have the pulpus coming out, but it's not completely ruptured. So this is more of a slip disc, and a herniated disc is when it starts just coming out, oozing out. There's a hole in it, and it starts oozing out. I like to use examples, because I think we learn better with examples. And the adjustments that you have to make for massage with this is if your client is walking in and they can barely walk and they can't get on the table and, you know, it's hard for them to get dressed, and you might want to wait until they're not in as much pain, because it's going to be hard for them to get on the table, hard for them to be comfortable. So you might want to wait, you know, until they're not in as much pain. And you want to accommodate with pillows. You know, it's hard for them to lay in the, you know, supine. You might want to do sideline, or, you know, just prone, and make sure you put, you know, support underneath their ankles or underneath their knees if they can go, supine. And the best advice that I can give my clients is that you can't. There's a lot of people that walk around that have, you know, a bulging or herniated disc, and one of the things that is important is for them to strengthen their core, you know, the obliques that form a natural girdle and the rectus abdominis, you know. So it's important to give them suggestions, you know. The goal, I think, of every massage therapist is first to figure out, you know, what's wrong with them, then give them a plan, you know, a plan of like how you're going to come in once a week or twice a week or whatever it's going to take to get them to a better place where they're not hurting. And then how do you, you know, strengthen those muscles, you know, and that's when they go to maybe physical therapy or, you know, get some advice from a doctor or physical therapist or, you know, so that they can strengthen those muscles so it doesn't continue to happen. So, I mean, the flare-ups, I mean. So anyway, so that's it, guys. The Alzheimer's, attention deficit, hyperactivity disorder, autism, Bell palsy, carpal tunnel syndrome, double crush syndrome, herniated and bulging disc. And I will have part two for you in the next time. And I hope that this is helpful to you. Please leave me comments and likes. I appreciate that. It helps with the algorithms. So thank you. And until the next time, create a great day.